Remember last time, I had a couple problems in my code. One was a PHP problem, the other probably related somewhat to CSS because it wasn't displaying the way I wanted to. I didn't really take the time to troubleshoot any of them because, you know, it was at near the end of class, and the CSS problem, again, I didn't want to spend a lot of time on that. There was PHP things I wanted to cover, and the PHP problem happened at the very end of class, so I didn't really troubleshoot that. So, in a way, I'm happy when I make mistakes in lecture, all right? That's good, right? Because I'm going to make mistakes in lecture, so I might as well enjoy them, right? And the reason that I enjoy them, or maybe enjoy is the wrong word, the reason that I think they're beneficial is I think it gives us an opportunity to talk about troubleshooting and debugging your code, because that's something that's inevitable. You know, you're going to have to do that at some point. I mean, no one is going to write the perfect code the first time through, so it's important to test and debug your code. And there's ways that you can do it better. You know, there's better methods than other methods, you know. And a good debugger will have sort of a lot of tools in their debugging toolbox or tool belt. And, you know, you want to be able to use them and hopefully throughout all the classes you have with me, you'll see me make enough different errors that you see a variety of tools that is in my own toolbox for debugging. So anyhow, I'm going to download what we had. I actually posted the corrected version, but I do want to go over how I figured them out, because again, that's pretty important stuff in my opinion. So let's refresh our memories. I'm going to download the error version, and I know the screen isn't on yet, but I'm not doing anything too critical yet. First thing I'm going to look at is a PHP error, because I can't even see the page yet, so I can't even troubleshoot the CSS error until I fix the PHP error. So I downloaded the code. I'm going to move it in place. By in place, I mean to where the web server needs to see it, which in this case is CINETPUB www.root. Clear out what was there before. So I'll copy these guys over. Then I'm going to go and type localhost. Since I just typed localhost, it will load the default page for this web server, which is a home page, which is called index.php. All right. That's why when you go to google.com or cnn.com or whatever, you don't have a name of a page, yet it still finds a page. When you configure a web server, you say that the file names correspond to the default page for that server. So if I remember right, the chart was the one giving me grief. I guess we can see the CSS problem on this page. This stuff is indented where I would have thought that it would have been aligned this way. So I go click on chart, and I just get an ugly error just saying, your page is broken. All right? Well, we really don't have any good options at this point if it just tells me that the page is broken. We could stare at our code, but that is like the worst way to try to debug your program, is just to stare at the code and hope that it jumps out. Now again, sometimes it works, but it's better to have some sort of systematic way, and it's better to have look at some evidence before you start investigating your code. You know, this would be like you know, going to a doctor and the doctor asking what's wrong. You say, I don't feel good. You know, well, okay, you don't feel good. You know, what am I supposed to do with that? You know, what's the doctor going to do? They're going to ask you some questions. They're going to run some diagnostic tests. They're going to, you know, listen to your heartbeat, take your blood pressure, do all those sorts of things. And then they might come up with an idea of what's wrong and try to fix it. So the problem here is that messages are good when you're developing your code, but they're bad when the code is in production. In other words, when I'm developing the code, I want to see the PHP error messages because I want that feedback of exactly what's wrong with the page. I want to know that, you know, line 38 has a problem or something like that, and I want as much information as possible. They're bad in production mode. In other words, when the site goes live, they're bad because they can give potential information that can compromise the security of the site. Information about database tables that are used and so on. So, therefore, by default, they're suppressed. And you can turn them on if you want to, if you're in development mode. So, where do you turn them on or off? There's a file that's called the PHP INI file. PHP-INI file. INI stands for initialization. I don't know if programs now, Windows programs, I don't know if they use INI files so much anymore, but they do?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, really? Okay. All right. What's nice about them is that they're easily configured. They're much more easily configured than, say, like the registry, going in and editing the registry. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to find the PHP INI file, we're going to make our edit to it, and then we're going to put it in place, and we'll hopefully get a better error message. Now, again, because of the goofy way permissions are set up on this machine, I'm going to find the PHP INI file, copy it, edit it on the desktop, and then copy it back. You probably won't need to do this on your particular machine. So I'm going to search for PHP INI. And the best match is here. I'm going to open the file location. So there's where it is. I'm going to copy it from the desktop, or from its location to the desktop. And I'm going to go and edit it with Notepad++. Now, the PHP INI file has a whole bunch of little directives, and there's a whole bunch of comments, first of all, that explains how the PHP INI file works. So it's sort of self-documenting. You know, for example, language options. Enable the PHP scripting language engine under Apache. Will it recognize, we've been using the PHP, we've been using the directive with the lesson sign, question mark, PHP. You can actually do a shorthand where you don't use the PHP, but I have that option turned off. How many digits do you display in floating point numbers? 14 of them, alright? And if we do a search for error, we're going to find all kinds of information about errors and errors that we display and so on. Display errors is a thing that we're looking for. There's all different kinds of errors that we can look for. There's different levels of errors that we can process and so on. And again, depending on whether you're in production or development mode, you might want to turn on one option or another option. For example, you might want to turn off warnings in production mode if you just get a warning on something. But in development mode, you would want to see all the warnings because a lot of times warnings are things that you want to take care of. You know, they're not essential and they won't keep your program from running, but if you have a warning, you might be doing something a little bit wrong and you might want to fix it just so that there's no further consequences. At any rate, we can find display errors, and currently it is set to off. And they even tell you the default value is off, the default value is on, the development value is on, the production value is off. So I'm not sure why this doesn't have the default, but when PHP was installed, this was installed, and the errors were turned off. So I'm going to turn the errors back on, and I'm going to save it. Now remember, I've saved it to the desktop, so I have to go and copy it back to its permanent location, which is in here. Do I want to replace it? It's going to give me the security warning. And it did it. So now when I go and view this page and I hit refresh, I get a meaningful error message, something I can at least do something with. And it says syntax error. Let me blow it up here. Syntax error, unexpected semicolon, expecting a right parenthesis in CINET pub wwroot chart.php on line 26. Well, that's pretty good information, you know. So let me go and look at that line of code, see what it looks like, and see how I can correct it. Said line 26. It said unexpected semicolon, expected a parenthesis. So when it says unexpected, it means that there's a character that is there that shouldn't be there. When it says expected, that means that it didn't see a character that should be there. So what this is telling me is there shouldn't be a semicolon right here. There should instead be a right parenthesis. So, I guess for loops in PHP don't have that last semicolon. All right. I think in JavaScript you can either put it in or leave it out, and I don't think it matters. But PHP, it cares. So I'll go save it. Copy it back to my web server's root. And refresh, and there we go. Everything's okay. Now remember, we put a debug value for the range. I just said the words range max. So that's part of our job today, is go in and actually put the range in. Now, if you also notice, there's sort of a CSS problem, because this should be aligning over here. All right. Now, we said we don't want to just stare at our code. How could we possibly debug this without simply staring at our code? What would be a better approach to debugging this CSS issue? What tools do we have to do that, or what techniques could we do?
Have Chrome's developers tools.
All right. Let's see if that tells us anything. Really have any errors here in the console. That's very good when we talk about JavaScript errors, to look at that, because that will tell us if there's any JavaScript errors that are occurring. But in this case, that's not the problem. There's other things we can do, all right, and we've talked about some of them in CISS 216, if you've had that with me, where you could make each element a different color and get a better idea of what's going on, or put a border on each element, or take out a chunk of CSS and see how that affects it, and then add pieces in gradually a bit at a time until you see what line of code breaks it. But I'm going to take a better approach here, because am I sure that it's a CSS problem? Well, here's my advice, all right? Unless you know exactly what the problem is, you can't be sure that the problem is this or the problem is that. Alright? So that was part of my problem actually when I looked at this on Monday, is I was convinced that it was a CSS problem. I was convinced I did something wrong with the CSS. Maybe I didn't do something wrong with the CSS. That's a little hint. So how could I tell if my CSS and HTML work? Well, there's a tool. There's a validator for that. So let me go and run my code through w3c.org, the validator. So let me put my CSS in here. Validate it. Congratulations, no errors found. There's not a problem with my CSS. So I was barking up the wrong tree last class when I was looking at the CSS, because there's nothing wrong with the CSS. Well, that leads to one other possibility, right? There's a problem with the HTML. Let's look at the HTML and see if we can find a problem with that. So let's go to the HTML validator. And even though this is a PHP file, let's see what happens when I run PHP through. PHP directives, which is understandable. We could get rid of those, and it probably still wouldn't give me an error. So, that's puzzling still. Alright? Still sort of puzzling. Yes?
What errors exactly is it look for? Syntax errors or compatibility errors? What
are you looking for? It's looking for, think of this as violating the rules of the language. So in this case, it's not giving me an error other than errors related to PHP, which, again, the validator doesn't understand PHP, so it doesn't give me an error. Well, I'm kind of stuck here. But the one thing that I feel good about is that the error might be in the HTML and not in the CSS. So I'm going to look at the HTML. I think I've eliminated in my mind the fact that the error is with the CSS. So I'm going to look at that code, and here about here is where it starts to go south. Between the header looks lined right, but the nav isn't. So let me look in those include files. Let me look first at the header include file, which did not get validated, right? Because the validator doesn't understand PHP.
You didn't get the closing tag.
I didn't get the closing tag for the header. We have a winner. Now, the other thing I could have done would be to do this. I could put a border on it, that might help me and so on. But in this case, yep, I saw it. So let me go and copy that over. And necessarily a perfect page, but I did want to show CSS and how we could do things with CSS on this. All right, so now we're at where we should have been yesterday at the end of class. All right, but I do think it's valuable because if anything, you know, use the tools that you have and try to, even if you ask me a question, you know, I usually try to take you through the process by which I determine the answer, sort of the logical process or the troubleshooting techniques or so on. If I ever do something and you're like, how did you know to do that? Feel free to ask. All right, so now I'm back here and I actually want to do the calculation. Because right now in my chart code, I'm going through and I'm simply outputting the words range and max there. All right, I want to actually output the real range and I want to output the real max. So, what am I going to do to do that? I'm going to create PHP functions. All right. And again, I'm going to do this one step at a time. The max is easier to calculate than the range, right? And the max is needed to calculate the range, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create the function to calculate the range. But guess what? I'm going to create it in a PHP include file because we know that we want to use this elsewhere. So I'm going to go new and go into PHP mode. I'm going to define a function. Called calculate max rate. What argument should this function have?
Should take in the age.
Should take in the age, right? Think about the arguments as like if you were doing it manually, what you would ask the person that was asking you to perform a function. So if you are a calculate maximum heart rate function, someone asks you, what's my maximum heart rate? Well, what would you ask? You'd ask, well, how old are you, right? And if you know how old they are, then you can calculate their maximum heart rate. If you were calculating the area of a square, and someone said, what's the area of the square? What would you ask? Well, what's the length of the size of the square? If you were to ask, what is the amount of my car payment? What would you ask? Well, you'd ask, how much are you financing? You know, what's the total amount of your loan? How many months are you financing it for? And what's your interest rate, right? The arguments to a function are the ingredients. They're what the function needs to do its job right. Now, part of what the function needs to do its job right is the formula or the algorithm to actually do the processing. But part of it is sort of the raw materials, the ingredients, what it's going to do it based off of. And in our case, it is based on the age. So we're going to make an argument for age. And what's the maximum? It's equal to 0.8 times arg age. Finally, I'm going to return. What's the return? The return is giving the answer back to whoever asked you the question. Now, a few things about return is you're returning the value of the variable. That variable max is not accessible outside of this function. All right. Later on, we'll probably talk about global variables. But the variable max is not accessible outside the function. So I can't refer to that variable, but I can refer to the value that is returned. So what I'm going to do in my chart is I'm going to put called the include file heart.inc. I'll go and save this file as that. I don't want to save it there. and save it on the desktop in my folder. Alright. Now I have to go to my chart and I have to include it, which I did. And now I have to call that function. So I'm going to go into PHP mode. And I'm going to say print. What's my function name? Calc max rate. And what argument am I going to give it? I'm going to give it the argument of age. And again, notice I didn't, you know, I'm not using inside my function that variable. I'm using the value of the variable. So the value of whatever variable I have gets put in this variable, and then I can use that. So that variable age is not accessible in the function. It's a good idea to have any communication between the function and the code that calls it to be done only by arguments and by return values. So everything the function needs, you give it as an argument. The function's response is simply to return a value. Now, notice that you might say to yourself, well, I'm returning the maximum, then I'm just going around and printing it. Why don't I just print the maximum right here? That would work for this particular column, but there's times I might want the maximum heart rate without displaying it on the screen. For example, when I calculate the minimum heart rate, I'm going to want to first calculate the maximum heart rate, and then I'm going to calculate the minimum by taking 50% of it. Likewise, when I create the maximum, or when I calculate the maximum heart rate, I'm first going to ask what is the maximum heart rate. And then I'm going to multiply by 80%. Alright? So, it's important for us to make the function only give back the value that it was intended to do and not do anything to it. So my function is going to simply output, so simply going to give whoever called it the number. Whoever called that function is going to decide what they want to do with it. Alright. So let's just check this out. Let's see if it works. So, let me go and copy chart and heart. To my web server root. And let's see. I'm being stupid and I opened up, this is a pain, I opened up the version in that was in the web server's root, not on the desktop. Okay, so hopefully I've moved the right files over. Oh. what's your maximum heart rate? It's 220 minus your age. You take 80% of that as the maximum rate for exercising. All right. So one more time. Like it worked, because 20-year-old the maximum heart rate is 200, 25, 195, and so on down the line. So I got that done. All right. So I now need to calculate the range that you should exercise in. And what's the range that you should exercise in? Well, the low end is 50% of that maximum. The high end is 80% of that maximum. So I could do one of two things. You tell me what sounds better. I could create one function that I give it the person's age, it calls the maximum, figures out the maximum heart rate for that person's age, calculates 80% or 50% of it, calculates 80% of it, concatenates those two numbers, puts a dash between them, and puts BPM after for beats per minute. So I could write one function that does that. All right? It's one function that does that and returns a string that represents the range. Another way I could do is I could write two functions. Calculate minimum exercise rate, calculate maximum exercise rate. Give it the age. All right? Give each of them the age. The minimum would take the age, call the maximum, get that number, multiply it by 50%, and output the 50% heart rate. The maximum would do the same thing, except it would multiply by 80%. The code that calls it then would take and concatenate those numbers and put BPM after them and display the result. So which do you think is better? Have one function that's going to output the entire range in a string, or two functions that are going to output the high end of the range, the low end of the range, and let whoever calls the code piece them together to form a string to output? Which of those do you think is better? Pardon me? Second one. I agree. And that might have been a very confusingly worded question. All right. Why the second one? Pardon me? There's separation, right. Each function does one job and one job alone. In other words, one calculates your minimum exercise heart rate. The other calculates your maximum exercise heart rate. All right. It's just a coincidence in this case that I want the minimum and maximum to be combined in a string. I could create a table that did something else that one, there was one column for minimum and one column for maximum. All right. Or maybe I would need to use the numbers in a different way. All right. Use a numerical comparison to see if the values are between the minimum and maximum. All right? The more that you can define your functions to do one specific job, the better off you are. So I'm going to write a separate function for each of these. So I'm going to go in here, and I'm going to say, calculate minimum exercise heart rate. So in order to do that, I first have to call calc max rate. I'm going to pass the argument to it. My answer is going to be 0.5 times my answer. And then I'm going to return the minimum. Or return the answer. The maximum is going to do the exact same thing. Except it's going to multiply by 0.8 and then return the answer. So now I have two functions, one of which returns a minimum exercise heart rate, one which returns a maximum exercise heart rate. So I simply need to call both of them, piece together the answer, and then output that. Piece of cake. So let's go into the chart. All right, here I'm going to have a little block of code. But that's okay, right? The only thing I'm going to send to the browser is the results of the print. So these other sort of intermediary calculations will get executed, but they won't get sent to the browser. So I can actually put some spaces here. And I can say, value 1 equals calculate minimum exercise rate give it the age value 2 equals calculate minimum or maximum exercise rate and then I can combine them and output them and the easiest way to combine them is with the magic quotes. So I can say, inside my magic quotes, val 1 dash val 2 space beat per minute. And I want to print it instead of pringing it. Pring is a new innovation. It's a cross between a print and a ping. I don't know what it does, but that would be a cool name for a function if it did do that. All right. So let's see what we got.
For a second, I thought you were like actually going to be serious. And like the pring was actually some weird thing.
Yeah, maybe it is. I don't know. All right, let me copy this over. Function calc min x rate. I spell everything correct. Val 1 equals calc min x rate. I think that's right. Yay, we can go home. Well, we should make sure the numbers are right? Just because you didn't get an error doesn't mean it's right. All right. So this is a fairly simple one because for every age, the algorithm's the same. It's not like there's a different algorithm depending on how old you are. It's always that your maximum rate is your a your 220 minus the age. So does that right? Well, for 20-year-old, yeah, a 20-year-old is 200. 220 minus 20 is 200. Okay. For the range, it's 50% of that and 80% of that. Well, that's right for 20. I would sample at least a couple more. All right, don't just look at one set of numbers because you could just coincidentally have a formula that happened to work out for one case. So let's look at 50. 220 minus 50 is 170. Okay, yeah, that's what the chart says. What's half of 170? 85. What is 80% of 170? Let me do the calculations in my head. Oh, look, it's 136. All right, so that's correct as well. This is a pretty straightforward one to test because, again, the formula is very basic, and there's not a lot of variation for that. Now, again, I might want to do some things to pretty this up. I might want to format, for example, to make sure. What I don't like is that the BPMs don't line up. You know, we could do some formatting of this and so on. And I could use some CSS to make it look prettier and so on. But essentially, the PHP part of it is done. All right. Now, where we are in good position is we now have functions that we can use on our other page. If you remember our other page, we're going to enter in someone's heart rate for 6 seconds. And we're going to enter in their age and their heart rate for 6 seconds. And we're going to tell them if they're in their optimal range. If they're in it, if they're under it, or if they're over it. All right? So that's what we'll do for our other page. Now, the good news is we've already done a lot of the work. Because if I wanted to figure out if I'm in the range, how would I do it? Well, I'd take my age, I'd figure out my maximum heart rate, I would get my minimum and maximum exercise rate, and then I'd see if my current heart rate is between those ranges. Now, since I'm only taking it for 6 seconds, I'd multiply it by 10, all right? And then I'd look and say, yeah, I'm exercising too hard, I'm exercising too lightly, all right? Okay, now, one thing. What if I move this include file way down to the bottom? Is that going to matter? I don't know. Let's find out. Instruction to calculate this, but the function hadn't loaded until you make it down there. You could run into a similar problem in JavaScript if you're not careful. That's why some of the stuff we do an onload event. We make sure that the page is loaded before we start messing with stuff. With PHP, PHP is I think technically it would be called a single pass interpreter. Which means that it starts at the beginning and it goes to the end. It doesn't, like, do a double pass like some of them do. And what does it mean, a single pass? It means if you're going to use something, like a function, it better be defined before you try to use it. Because if it's defined somewhere later on in the code, it doesn't know about that yet. Hasn't gotten to it yet. So it literally, PHP literally reads the code from the beginning and does its best to process it. And in this case, it hits this function. That function doesn't exist because that function isn't defined until down here. All right. and therefore it runs into difficulties. So if you have functions, it's a good idea to put them at the very beginning of your page. You can even put it like way up here. Because now that will load immediately as the page is being processed. And you'll avoid the situation we ran into a minute ago. All right, so we're back in business. All right, next time what we're going to do is we're going to write our other page, the calculator. And we're going to write that in such a way that we leverage the functions that we've done already. All right. If I look at these functions that I created, these are functions that I potentially could use at a bunch of different places in my site. All right. And they're good functions because they accept arguments, and they're good functions because they return their results. So they could work as a black box. All right. You can call these in a standalone mode and you don't have to worry about anything else being on the page. So I can take these functions and very easily reuse them because anything they need to do their job, they get passed in as an argument and they simply output their result. So I might add some functions to this, all right, but I do have a good starting point for this and I'm not reinventing the wheel. That's a big goal for software development. Think of all the things that we do in web development to put all our code in one place so that we can reuse it. We create external CSS files. We just saw last time how we create PHP include files. And now we are putting functions in those include files so that we can include them on a variety of different pages so that we don't have to reinvent the wheel each time. Any questions about this? All right, I'm going to post this example, I'm first of all going to make sure, because I'm a little worried that I was editing one version of the file and looking at the other version between these two places, so I'm going to go in and make sure it still works, which it does. Good. Now I can go and upload this guy. All right, we'll see you over in lab.